Yamuna Tiravanachari. Yamuna Tiravanachari. Jayo Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jai Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jai Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jai Gopi Janavallabha Girivaradhari. Yashoda Nandana Braja Janaranjana. Yashoda Nandana Braja Janaranjana. Yashoda Nandana Braja Janaranjana. Yashoda Nandana Braja Janaranjana. Yamuna Tiravanachari. Yamuna Tiravanachari. Jayo Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Gopi Janavallabha Girivaradhari. Yashoda Nandana Braja Janaranjana. Yashoda Nandana Braja Janaranjana. Yashoda Nandana Braja Janaranjana. Yashoda Nandana Braja Janaranjana. Yamuna Tiravanachari. Yamuna Tiravanachari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari.
Jayam Vishnupada Paramahansa Parivraja Gacharya Stutra Srimad Divine Grace Abhay Charanarvind Bhakti Vedanta Swami Jagadguru Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai Ananta Koti Vaishnavrinda Ki Jai Namacharya Srila Haridas Thakur Ki Jai Granthraj Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai Gaura Premanandi. All glorious assembled devotees, all glorious assembled devotees, all glorious assembled devotees, All glories to Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, chapter entitled The Philosophy of Sankhya, text number 29. It's the last verse of this chapter. Eshah Sankhya Vidhi Proktaha Samshaya Granthi Bhedanaha Pratiloma Anuloma Bhyam Para Avara Drisha Maya Esa Sankhya Vidhi Prokta Samshaya Granthi Esa Sankhya Vidhi Prokta Samshaya Granthi Bhedanaha Pratiloma Anuloma Bhyam Paravara Drishamaya Esa Sankhya Vidhi Prokta Samshaya Granthi Bhedanaha Prati Loma Anuloma Bhyam Paravara Drishamaya Esa Sankhya Vidhi Proktaha Samshaya Granthi Bhedanaha Prati Loma Anuloma Bhyam Paravara Drishamaya Loma Anulobhyam Prati Loma Anuloma Bhyam Paravara Drishamaya Ladies, Esha Sankhya Vidhi Proktaha Samshaya Granthi Bhedanaha Prati Loma Anuloma Bhyam Paravara Drishamaya Esha, this Sankhya Vidhi Method of Sankhya, analytical philosophy. Proktaha, spoken. Samshaya, of doubts. Granthi, the bondage. Bhedanaha, which breaks. Pratiloma anuloma bhyam. In both direct and reverse order. Para, the situation of the spiritual world. Avara, the inferior situation of the material world. Drisha, by him who sees perfectly. Maya, by me. Translation proper by the disciples of Srila Prabhupada. Thus I, the perfect seer of everything, material and spiritual, have spoken this knowledge of Sankhya, which destroys the illusion of doubt by scientific analysis of creation and annihilation. Purport. Lord Sri Krishna has explained that
The material mind accepts and rejects many different concepts of life, generating innumerable false arguments about the actual process of perfection. But a person who takes shelter of the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead can see everything with clear intelligence. One who understands how the Supreme Lord creates and annihilates can be liberated from material bondage and devote himself to the eternal service of the Supreme Lord. Thus end the purport of the humble servants of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, to the 11th canto, 24th chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam, entitled The Philosophy of Sankhya. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Sri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamahiyam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathan Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Shahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Sri Vishakhan Vitamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinabandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Bhavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Sri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare This is the ongoing discussion of two best friends, Krishna, Sri Krishna, and his Haridasa warrior friend, Yudhishthira Maharaj. Uddhavji are considered as the best among the servants of Sri Krishna. So these two exalted personalities are speaking. And we are fortunate that for so many thousands of years, we are still able to reminisce, read, discuss, understand, and practice these lofty principles which are discussed by the Lord. The Lord being the summum bonum of all compassion. Whatever He does is always good for all mankind, for all living beings. And therefore, whatever He speaks or does is with that mood of benefiting all of us who will seriously take His instructions to heart. In this particular last verse, the Lord is educating us that it is very simple for a person to navigate to the rough course of material existence if he accepts some very simple, fundamental, basic principles of navigation. Navigation means you are in the ocean. And the ocean is by definition a directionless entity. Because if you're in the middle of the ocean, there is absolutely no trees, buildings, malls, signals to tell you where you are going. Right? It is just your middle of everywhere you see there is only water, right? So our existence also is considered like we are in the Bhava Sagara. Our existence is compared to our existence in the ocean. So what is the possibility, probability? Now, how many directions can a person take? Okay, I think the shore is on that side. If I keep my boat moving this side, someone says, no, I think the shore is going to be this side. So as he says here, there are innumerable false arguments as to about the actual process of purity, of perfection. So literally when in the ocean, you can find tens of thousands of directions of which side, first here, then here, then here. You can keep on trying, thinking when will you at last reach your destination, the shore across the ocean. Does it make any sense to use that process to reach your destination? Is there any scientific logic to say, I'll figure it out my way? By speculative knowledge, by analysis, by various means, I'll figure it out myself. If you just were to take a simple foundational principle, let me just buy a compass. Let me just buy a simple compass and I will know immediately what is the north and the south. If I know what is the north, I know what is the south. If I know what is north and south, I know what is the east and I know what is the west. And I know all the directions in between. And that will simply take me in the right direction. So also, the unlimited confusion in the religious circles, theological circles, right? About what is God, what is the purpose of creation, why is there suffering in this world? Is God impersonal or personal? Is God connected to his creation? This and that, wrangling, unlimited wrangling of philosophical debates going on, right? And they all call themselves as scholars of comparative religion, scholars of theology, theosophy, and this and that, right? All these departments of ignorance exist because of not accepting one simple principle which Krishna teaches in the fourth chapter. Tad vidhi pranipatena pariprashtena sevaya obdekshanti te jnanam jnaninas tattva darshinah. Right? It is said the beginning of knowledge is humility. There cannot be anybody in this world who will learn anything in this world, anything literally, if he does not accept the principle of humility. When we go to our schools, we are taught how to hold the pen. We don't challenge. Why should a pen hold the pen like this? Pencil. In school, we use pencil. Why don't I use it between these two fingers? Why don't you do it? Do we do that? Why is A like this? Why not A like this? One like that. Why is A like this? No child ever argued like that. Why be like this, right? We simply accepted what the teacher taught us. Hold a pen like this, okay. Now make one line like this, and one like that, and one in between. This is A for apple. And we simply accepted it. Until today also, with all our PhDs and all, we're still accepting A is equal to apple, it's for apple. We never challenge why A is like this and not other way around, right? Because we humbly accepted what the teacher taught us. Mummy said, do like this. Mummy said, okay. Mummy is saying is right. Papa is saying is right. Because teacher is authority. Mama is authority. Papa is authority. Correct? So, knowledge means first humbling ourselves to authority. When you go to a science classes, laboratories, we don't say, why this is picric acid? Why this is sulfuric acid? Why this is not hydrochloric acid? What stupid nonsense is that? Right? This is picric acid, You know, mix it two and see some precipitate will come. Correct? We simply followed. And we just have to observe. Oh, there's a black precipitate. This is calcium carbonate or something. right? So all agile process, we go through process of humility. However, the stupid thing about the whole thing is that when it comes to spiritual subjects, we start showing our color. What is the proof? Who saw it? Have you seen it? Right? What is the authority? How do you know? Only in the realm, the hypocritical nature of human beings, which is typical of Kali Yuga, is when they come to the realm of spirituality, they start showing as if they're very intelligent, rational, you know, logical, scientific people. Everything else in the world they'll accept through authority only. Somebody, some friend said, picture acha hai, wo dekhne ko jayega. Somebody said, the picture is good, he'll go and see it. Right? Everything which goes about by telling, but when it comes to spirituality, I'll figure it out. So, that is such a waste of time. If you simply accept, as it says here, but a person who takes shelter of the lotus feet of the personality of Godhead, we can see everything with clear intelligence. How wonderful is that? So for a pure devotee, nothing is unknown. Nothing is unknown. Prabhupada can talk to scientists, Prabhupada can talk to scholars, Prabhupada can talk to politicians, Prabhupada can talk to any of these people, and nobody ever prevailed over Prabhupada's understanding of the absolute truth. With all their multiple PhDs, they simply understood that this man knows far more than what we know. Because he was learning from the perfect source, that is Krishna. Right? So it is so wonderful, because all of us are so happy in this room here, not because of anything else, not that because we have so much, but we just have a clear understanding about the goal of life from the perfect source, that is Krishna. How wonderful is that? And that is why a sadhaka's heart goes in gratitude to the spiritual masters who have preserved this knowledge which was generated at the time of creation. There is nothing in this world today which has lasted from time of creation. No empires, no buildings, no forts, no pillars, no human being. Nothing has lasted from creation till now. Nothing, literally nothing. Everything has been destroyed by time. Only one thing continues to exist, which was created at the time of creation. And that is transcendental knowledge. Transcendental knowledge. Because it is coming from the Lord is indestructible. So knowledge produced by Him also is by nature indestructible. Of course, there can be like an eclipse can come over the sun and therefore temporarily may get covered. Yoga nashta parantapa. But the sun always exists. The eclipse can come for a few hours and may appear that it is lost. But so Krishna to speak the knowledge again to Arjuna. But the knowledge is never non-existent. It is prakat, aprakat. Right? So only transcendental knowledge is produced at the time of creation. It was given to Brahma at the time of creation. Tene Brahma rida adhakavaya. Adhakavaya means Brahma. And that knowledge is coming to us in 2020. When was Brahma born? Where are we? Still, same thing we know. What a miracle. Undistorted, unchanged. We are so sure. We are absolutely so sure and confident that what we are learning today is exactly what Krishna wanted us to learn when he gave knowledge to Brahma billions of years ago. Billions. We don't even have a count of how many years back is that. And yet, our hearts are sold out completely to this system of knowledge with complete faith and confidence that we are not being cheated, we are not being swayed, we won't have surprise at the end of our life. We know what we are doing. As a Russian devotee at the time of departure said, Prabhupada never cheated us. And no, he didn't say that. What did he say? This process works. The young man who's dying of cancer, We know the story, right? And before leaving this body, he said these words. The young Vaishnava said, the process works. Right? So, that is the whole thing about intelligence. When we go by the mind's nature and the intelligence nature has to be understood. Right? Like we understand, what the scientific man understands, the nature of the molecules, the cells, the mitochondria, the nucleus, the chromosomes. We understand the nature of various things. So we also understand that with us or within us is a mind, we have an intelligence. And they both have their typical natures. As it says over here very clearly, the nature of the mind is very, very specific knowledge to accept and to reject. And you can see typically in this world how it happens. People get married because they fall in love or they like somebody, they like the looks, they like the profile, whatever, whatever. They get married. But then the mind accepts, so that tomorrow after 5 years, 2 years, 3 months, I don't like. So I reject this partner, accept some other partner, divorce, new partner, right? So this is simply because we are going by our mind. I like this car, today I don't like this car. I like this dress, I don't like this dress, rejected. Right? So the mind is a very, anybody who founds his life on the basis of what the mind dictates is sure enough going to suffer so much. The mind is so flickering. It can never stay in one place for too long. The example is of a restless child. You know, all our children will say, you go to the pediatrician or any, they said, most parents will have the same dialogue to say, mera beta, mera bacha both hyper hai. Right? Most children, parents will say like that. Hyper. Hyper means, you know, he will not sit in one place. They come to our OPDs, and then we are talking to the parents, he will touch something. Then he will open it up, and he will take the stethoscope. He will pull up something. He said, beta, nahi karna hai na aisa? Injection marega doctor. You tell him whatever is about, he will still keep on doing something, right? The restless. I mean, that is his nature. What to do? What can a child do? That is his nature. And as Kali Yuga progresses, his nature becomes more prominent because of all the agitating chemicals that go into his brain coming from the mother's blood at the time of birth. Because she's eaten such so many agitating foodstuffs. So there is so much inflammation in his brain. Inflamed brain can never be peaceful. He's always giving some signals. Neuronal excitation goes on. So he's a child, he's always doing like this, right? So there's a nature of a child. So our mind is like that. It will keep on latching on to different things. Never ever satisfied. No matter what you give the mind, never satisfied. The best thing you give, it will never be satisfied. Something else. The intelligence is a fixation modality of consciousness. Right? Unless you bring the intelligence into the purview of your life very actively, you cannot fixate your mind on anything which you want to fixate it upon. And that is called as concentration. Concentration is not a modality of the mind. Mind cannot by nature concentrate. You have to fixate the mind on a subject by bringing in the purview of the intelligence who will just take a nail and tuck, you hit the nail and then, okay, now it is fixated. It will stay in the wall for, till the wall exists. Right? So that is intelligence. And therefore, in the spiritual circles, among spiritual sadhakas, the focus is on only one thing if you go to see. Subduing the nature of the mind and promoting the nature of the intelligence. How to keep the mind under check from his very nature. Chanchal Himana Krishna, Paramati Balavar Tridam, Trasa Manya, Bhavaritam Sudushkaram. That nature is the mind, is which is, if you all know, to how to curb that, subdue that, weaken it up, and use intelligence to overpower that. The typical example of this, which is applicable to all sadhakas, is the example of Dhritarashtra. Dhritarashtra is a person who knows Krishna is God, who knows he is the infallible absolute truth. He knows he is Vasudev, he is God incarnate in response to the prayers of the demigods. He knows all this stuff. He has knowledge. But typically, Yudhishthira Maharaj is Dhritarashtra is torn between two things. Attachment of his mind to Dushasana and Duryodhana on one side, and the good counseling from the other side of Vidura and Bhishmadev. Imagine his position, which is typically, this is a typical example of our position also. Therefore, the example of Shastra is extremely important for Sadhaka to understand. On one side is his mind, which is attached. As we said, the nature of the mind is to get attached. Goes on. To Duryodhana and Dushasana, Putra Moha. Right? And imagine having two Mahajans in your family. Two Mahajans are here to guide Dhritarashtra. Yamaraj Shakshat coming as Vidura and Bhishmadev also. Two Mahajans are there to counsel you at one time. Right? Mahajan, not some ordinary counselor who has learned Sigmund Freud and Stephen Covey. Not like that. Somebody who actually has Tattva Darshana, who knows, who are pure devotees of Krishna. That means they know everything clearly. Clear intelligence is there. They know exactly what's happening. They know there's no confusion in Bhishma's mind, what to do, what not to do. He's completely convinced. He knows exactly what is what, right, wrong, good, bad, sapata. Vidura also knows exactly, clear intelligence. And these two are, and Dhritarashtra is so fortunate to have these two as his biggest well-wishers in life. He has the love of Vidura and Bhishma to such an extent, they simply just love him. And after the love, they want to counsel him, guide him, correct him, chastise him, whatever. And yet we find Dhritarashtra always, almost always, till the very end, fag end of his life, gravitating always towards the lower nature of the mind. Mind means gravity. Intelligence means anti-gravity. Mind will always drag us down. The principle of gravity acts on the mind always. It degrades the consciousness. It corrupts the consciousness. That is the nature of the mind. Unless it is purified by contact with devotional service, of course, that is there. And we're talking about a conditioned state. And intelligence is always anti-gravity. So that's why we have a lower self and we have a higher self. When the self is guided by the intelligence and senses, it is called lower self. When it is guided by the intelligence and higher knowledge, authority is called as higher self. Therefore, for us, the only tapasya of life of a sadhaka is how to keep the intelligence always fortified. Just like you have muscle power to do strong things, to lift big things, you got muscle power, biceps. Right? So, a devotee requires strong intelligence.
On February 19th, 1966, in New York.
So, when a devotee understands this, that I have to keep my intelligence clear, And that is why the first devotional act for a sadhaka is hearing. Shravana, then kirtana, then smarana, then vandana, then dasyam, then archanam, sakyam. It goes on like that. But it has to start always with shravana. And therefore it is an indefeatable, unquestionable, non-negotiable entity for a person who wants to make progress in Krishna consciousness. Even before chanting comes hearing. Before you get the bead bag, you have to do a JOSD course, where you have to simply go and hear. On the fifth day, you'll be getting a bead bag and a sticker and some books. And hopefully that person is convinced to chant. But before he takes the bead bag, he has to first hear, right? And that principle from which he started his spiritual life journey continues the same progress till he dies, till he finishes. He has to keep on doing one thing. What is that? Keep on hearing. And then the chanting has some value and meaning. Then the bhakti process of other, now the bhakti has got some value in this thing, because he gets the proper attitude, the mood, the spirit, the intent, all depends exclusively on what is the quality of his receptive hearing. Once he stops hearing, even if he continues everything else, it becomes a drudgery, a ritual, a burden. Becomes mundane. Becomes ordinary. Becomes routine. And does not satisfy the soul. And therefore, to constantly feed the devotional activities with proper shravanam is the only way in which you remain enthused about what you are doing. And therefore, there is this emphasis on Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya. Everybody, right? We must hear every day. Otherwise, things, as we said, the mind is so powerful, again, the gravity factor will act and everything becomes just mundane, routine. This goes down, goes down, goes down. But the devotee who always reads and hears the scripture, will never feel bored of spiritual life, will never feel this is routine. He will always be overflowing with enthusiasm and gratitude for having received this rare gift, which is something which is so rarely available in this creation, this world. Transcendental knowledge, Divya Jnanam. And then when he remains enthused with this, then he gets that rasa. The rasa. When he does enthusiasm, he gets that rasa. And that rasa is required for experiencing higher taste. The higher taste comes because of rasa. Right? And when the more he experiences the rasa of higher taste, of Krishna Katha, Krishna Kirtan, Krishna Seva, right? Krishna Prasad, of course. Not to forget that. The more he gets, relishes his rasa, the more he has the power to subdue the mind. The mind will always pull him towards Chapala Sukha Rasa. There's rasa there also. In Chapala Sukha also there is rasa. But unless you get the higher rasa, we will gravitate towards Chapala Sukha Rasa. But if we have to invest our consciousness into long-term sukha, Brahma Sokhyam to Anantam, if we have to go towards that direction of Rishabhdev's teaching, Brahma Sokhyam to Anantam, unending Sokhyam, if you have to go towards that direction, then you require constant relishing of devotional rasa, because that keeps you enlivened. Yes. And even though the mind may start playing tricks, you're always hearing, and therefore you don't get subdued by the mind. Mind may, the nature, get depressed, you know, something happens in our life, some relationship issues take place between devotees, family members, something, and the mind gets disturbed, get depressed. Why does he say that? Why did he do that? Why is she doing that? All this will happen in the mind, because being in the practical living, the real world, the mind will get fractured, they will be affected by things, the events of this world, which will always not go into the direction which we want. But no matter what happens in our life, and no matter what the mind gets affected by, circumstantial situations, because the intelligence is always being fed, he will remain fixed on his goal. And that is called as Ekeha Kuru Nandana. Fixed on the path. No matter what happens in his life, which will happen, no matter what you do, what vratas you do, what Nagbali, and what is that called? Pitru dosha, whatever. All sorts of things you do, talisman you wear, and whatever else you do, your karmic reactions will to come. You may just postpone things by doing this and that, but you cannot negate any karma. There is no way to negate karma by any anusthan, any yagya, any bali, kuch nahi. Karmani nirdahati kintu jabhakti bhajam. That's it. You can only negate karma by the power of bhakti. And all these things are all only working at a subtle level, but there is no way of getting free from the effects of these things. It is just some temporary painkiller effect. You have pain, you take painkiller, pain gaya, chalo achha lagta. It's all like painkillers. But the problem is still there. The arthritis is still there. The painkiller is taken, I'm feeling relief. Oh, 6 months, no problem. Or change my joint, no problem. The problem is still there. So only bhakti has the power to negate karma, because Krishna takes charge of your karma. And he says, Ma suchaha, don't worry about your karma problem. When he says, don't fear, means he's saying, don't worry about your karma and all that stuff. Right? I'll take care of all that. I will delete that for you. You just keep on going in the path which we have to go. And therefore, the bliss and the pleasure of, we cultivate this cultivation to read more, to discuss more. When we look at Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Gadadhar Pandit, exalted personalities, Sri Radha and Sri Krishna, living at Tota Gopinath temple, what are they doing when they meet? They are relishing the rasa of Srimad Bhagavatam. Right? When Thakra Haridas is there, Mukunda Dutt is there, Sri Advaita Acharya is there, what are these great souls doing? If we are supposed to follow, if we are all followers, that means we have to follow. We are followers. We are following. Whom? Leaders. Mahajans. If we're supposed to follow, what are these great souls relishing? What is the thing which gives them pleasure? Their pleasure is in Hari Kirtan, Hari Katha. And how much they relish this. In the Mukund Mala Stotra by Koinkulu Shakar Maharaj, said, my dear Lord, I am not doing these various things of rituals of devotional service for getting some nice apsaras to live with. Cha-cha. He's saying, no. I don't want to, touch their soft bodies and feel some sort of a sensual experience. And I'm not even doing it for, I want to get free from the Kumbhi Pak. Means all this suffering which will come. This is not my purpose. I'm simply doing it because there is so much, I am so much relishing this. In the house of my heart, he says, Hridaya Bhavane. House is like a heart. And the heart is like a house. Hridaya Bhavane, right? In my heart, in the house of my heart, I am relishing so much this pleasure that the pleasure of being with Apsaras is insignificant for me. It can't compare. Chitrana Charitamrita goes even one step higher in the story of, in the Panihati story. There's a sloka which says, Krishna Pada Padma Gandha. Krishna Pada Padma Gandha. Yehi jana pai. Brahma Loka Adisuka Tara Nahi Pai. simply by smelling the aroma, the gandha of Krishna Pada, the fragrance emanating from Krishna's lotus feet. Yehi janapai. One just smells that. Brahma loka adi sukha. Forget apsaras. Apsaras are very low because we are talking about swarga loka. Then jana, jana mahara, then a tapa. All these things are, there are four layers beyond that. Brahma loka adi, all of them, etc., 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 etc. Tara nahi bhai. All pleasures, now this may appear hyperbolic to a conditioned mind. This is all exaggeration in the scripture. They keep on doing that. That is the element of Shraddha. Are we going to consider these slokas of Kaviraj Goswami, who is Kasturi Manjari from the spiritual world, right? Am I going to take her revelations as hyperbolic, poetic exaggerations of spiritual rasa? Or I'm going to take them, as Prabhupada says, as it is? Am I going to take Rupa Goswami's words when he says, I want to have millions of ears to chant, to hear, and I want millions of tongues to chant, right? Now Rupa Goswami is saying this. Now what is our realization in this particular realm? Do we want more, two tongues to chant or five tongues to chant? In one tongue also is getting tired chanting. Kabhi khatam hoega. And 2 years, are we wanting to have so many years to hear the holy name? Because 2 years are not enough cups to absorb the sound vibration. They need more of these cups to absorb the sound vibration. There's scarcely our understanding of the glory of the holy name. Maybe the kirtaniyas who do kirtan regularly, they may be relishing. I don't know. I'm not a kirtaniya. But the kirtaniyas, when they sing the harmonium and they sing various ragas, of classical ragas with devotional heart, and maybe they think like that, oh, I want to have thousands of tongues and millions of ears. But for ordinary sadhaka like myself, don't think like that. But are we going to still negate this as hyperbolic? It is not true. It is not hyperbolic because Krishna is the reservoir of all pleasure, Prabhupada said. Not some pleasure or most pleasure. Prabhupada said, all pleasure. There was holy name also is the reservoir of all pleasure. So how can ordinary muscle of 3 inches by 2 inches be enough for relishing all pleasure? How can a small ear hole, how much is a ear hole diameter? 1 by 1 centimeter is our ear hole. Ear is, pinna is big, pinna is very big, but the ear hole is only 1 by 1 centimeter, right? So how much is that ear hole enough to gather the sound vibration? It's not enough, correct? So you require millions of ears. So when these statements are being made, it is to increase our hankering. What is this rasa? What is this anandam buddhi vardhanam rasa? And also it challenges our mundane conditioning to think, why am I, the stupid mind of mine, still attached to all these flickering, temporary, fleeting pleasures of this world? It is strongly challenging. Am I still, after so much of transcendental knowledge, I have heard, when I say I means all of us, hundreds and thousands of lectures by now. I've read thousands of verses by now, and dozens of yatras I've done, and so much I've done in Krishna consciousness, but am I going to be cheated by my mind to still drag me down towards the lower pleasures of the flesh and the pleasures of name, fame, position? Am I going to allow myself to be cheated by that stupid mind which has hijacked my consciousness for millions of lifetimes? Or am I going to really hanker for that rasa which Rupa Goswami is talking about? That rasa which Gadadhar Pandit and Mahaprabhu Chaitanya are relishing at Todagovan temple. What the great souls, when with Vidura and Maitreya are talking, when coming together, what they are relishing. Am I going to really hanker for that pleasure or for the lower pleasure? And if I go for the first modality, then yes, I am rightly situated. That even though I am not relishing that right now, but definitely it is in store for me. And as Prabhupada said, just give this one lifetime and you will experience this. This is waiting for you. This ocean of nectar is waiting for you. But the only entrance exam, like you have entrance exam for IIT, entrance exam, this entrance exam is exam also, and it is actual entrance also. It's not after entrance exam you have to do a course, right? Usually the entrance exam means they do entrance exam, and after exam then they do a 6 years course or something is there. Then you can do the course. This is like entrance exam, and then you actually get entrance. You don't have to do that course also. So we simply believe with faith that if I can invest my mati of this one lifetime, which is now a few years only, maybe most of the time our half the life is already gone. So half my life is remaining. We can just invest that with faith in what Prabhupada is saying, Krishna is saying. And what awaits me? Eternal life awaits me. There is no birth, there is no death, there is no disease, there is no suffering. But existence with Krishna, the reservoir of all pleasure. Prabhupada said, we are inviting everyone to come and join Krishna's eternal dance. Look at Prabhupada's invitational language. Just we are inviting the whole world to come and join Krishna in his eternal dance. Everyone can dance with Krishna in the spiritual world. Prabhupada is inviting us. How wonderful is our process. How glorious is bhakti, right? How undeserving we are, and yet how blessed we are at the same time. And definitely we want to, as Krishna is telling us here, one who understands how the Lord creates, annihilates, and can be liberated from material bondage and devote himself to eternal service of the Supreme Lord. Our nature is to enjoy life, but not enjoy life independent of God. Enjoy life in conjunction with God, in cooperation with God, in subordination to God. So we are not annihilating or challenging our enjoying nature, our Ananda Bhasad nature. We are not challenging that. But we are just making a small paradigm shift, rather than enjoying life independent of Krishna. We want to enjoy life in conjunction to his eternal subordination and his will. And then Krishna will share the love of his heart. Whatever Krishna is relishing, he will share that with us. Now, what is Krishna relishing? And if somebody shares that with us, our hearts will explode in joy. Right? Krishna is willing to share that with us. Let's be convinced of this. And that's what Prabhupada is inviting us for. So let that new year 2020 be with this added resolve, that greater resolve of fixating our mind and through a purified intelligence, which has been coming to us by the mercy of Sri Guru, the sadhus, and the shastras. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So we'll end here. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki jai.